Many economists who advocate for a reduced role of the state, particularly in developing countries, focus on the negative effects of corruption and argue that, by constraining the state to act in a more liberal way, such corruption can be reduced. In this video, I want to look at some of the counter-arguments to this position from economists in favor of more direct government intervention to promote development. This includes arguments that 1. The benefits of many policies outweigh the possible cost of corruption, and that liberal arguments are based on overestimating the developmental potential of free markets. 2. Liberalization does not always remove corruption, but often just creates different forms of corruption. 3. Historically, corruption has been present in many fast-growing economies. This does not mean that corruption should be condoned, but rather that not all forms of corruption are barriers to development. And further, that reducing some forms of corruption may only be possible after significant economic growth and not before. What are rents? Rents are payments people or firms get above what they would earn in a hypothetical competitive market. Note that some low-cost firms can still earn a high profit in competitive markets, because market prices are determined by the firms in business with the highest production costs. These profits are not considered rents, and reducing them will not improve efficiency in the neoclassical model. Additionally, rents from owning scarce natural resources do not reduce efficiency. Rents from market power, government transfers, and rewards for innovation and learning are more controversial. Mushtaq Khan argues that these can have both positive and negative effects on growth. This is based on heterodox models where firms compete not through cutting prices, but through upgrading technology, and this upgrading is often financed or rewarded through rents. For example, profits from patents. Government transfers are also used to allocate rents to sectors which are seen as important for development, in order to push firms to adopt new technologies and improve productivity. However, while these transfers can drive capitalist development, they are often regressive, i.e., they transfer from poorer classes to a newly forming bourgeoisie. What is rent-seeking? A second major claim of neoclassical economists is not only that rents are wasted resources, but also that when there are rents, large firms go to considerable effort competing for them, and this creates a whole new source of waste. This can be due to lobbying, bribery, and corruption to get government support, or simply misused resources to comply with government conditions to get support. For example, building excess capacity just to earn government contracts. This competition for rents is what is called rent-seeking. The argument that rent-seeking is extremely costly for developing countries, and so rents should be reduced wherever possible, was put forward by neoclassical economists, such as Alan Krueger, former World Bank chief economist. However, heterodox institutional economists argue that rent-seeking is an inherent part of any shift in rights. And to understand the effect on society, we must compare how society operates under different rights structures. They argue that rent structures can be vital to maintaining political stability and development. Thus, the question for heterodox economists is not how to eliminate rents, but rather, how can rents be managed to increase development and kept away from unproductive groups? Here it is important to separate the concept rent-seeking from corruption more broadly. Many types of lobbying involved in rent-seeking are legal, and many government-created rents do not harm the economy. However, large government-created rents can be allocated through bribery or other illegal forms of lobbying, and attempts to capture government rents can be unproductive or actively harmful, such as when government contracts for vital services and infrastructure are awarded to firms unable to supply them or supplying them below a minimum quality. Thus, there is a large overlap between the concept of rent-seeking and corruption, but the two are not interchangeable.
Rent management.
So, how can rents be allocated to productive uses? One option is that strong states with a degree of political autonomy can often effectively discipline firms who do not use rents to improve productivity. However, this requires states which have enough power to reallocate rents from poor performing firms. But states in many developing countries do not have this degree of power, and are often too dependent on some firms to be able to discipline them. This is a major issue which Mr. Khan tackles, suggesting that incremental and strategic policies against harmful rent-seeking is still possible, even by compromised states, but that for policies to be successful, they must be in line with the interests of powerful sectors in society. Further, he argues that development is the cause of major reductions in corruption, and not the other way around. So, it is better for developing countries to target specific types of corruption which are most easily fixed and harmful to development. He argues that while more widespread anti-corruption is an important goal, it is neither a precondition for development, nor even possible without significant economic development preceding it. Again, this process does not entail the reduction of government-created rents, or liberalization of industrial policy advocated for by some neoclassical economists.